And live. Good evening, everybody. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is a Wednesday night webinar. We've decided that we're going to do webinars every Monday and Wednesday night at 9 p.m. That's 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And during the day on Wednesday and Monday mornings, there'll be a login code. And what you'll be able to do is you'll be able to register and then log in. But I think, I'm pretty sure that it's as long as I keep this going, it'll be the same login code for every single week. So I'm pretty sure. Let me know if you can hear me okay. I'm actually broadcasting in HD and I'm using a mic, which has been working out really, really great for me. And on my end, it sounds wonderful. And I'll do my best. My camera is actually above my laptop and I'll do my best to look into the camera. But if I'm reading a question, the questions are actually right in my chat box. Knowing that those, good evening. Hey, Michelle, how are you? Michelle says, good evening. Knowing that they're in my chat box, I have to look down. So I'm really excited about this. The reviews have been really great about my Monday webinar. Probably was one of my best ones ever. And I know it's late for my folks over in overseas, in London, in Germany, in Australia. I don't know, for in Australia, you guys might be in the morning, and in Russia. I know Patty sounds good. Jack sounds great. Thank you so much. Debbie, okay, that's wonderful. Thank you so much. And then all for my West Coast people, that it's 6 o'clock, and then my Chicago people, it's 8 o'clock. So I decided to move it till 9. Also, coincidentally, I just put Angelo to bed, so it works out for me personally. So I'm actually doing it for purely selfish reasons. If you've never attended one of my webinars before, I can't thank you enough for taking time out of your day to attend my webinar. It really means a lot to me. The bottom line is, if I have nobody asking questions, I have no webinar. These are my questions right there. That's my script. So it's all you. Hey, Sarah, good evening. Jeff, you sound great. Fantastic. You're looking great, Sarah. So it's important that people ask me questions, and I'm going to be as direct and sometimes quick. I'm a quick talker. And unlike all those books that you've studied on people, quick talkers are not liars. All right. So I read that same book too. And so it's really, really great. Doug H waiting to get connected. I see you. So I see you there. So I'm not quite sure. If you're having any video problems, chances are it is on your end. I've got a really, really strong signal here. We make sure that I actually shut off all of the devices in my home, so nobody's trying to share my bandwidth with me. Patty says, Jeff, first of all, thanks for all you do for us. This is my first live one, so I'm excited to participate. Patty, I'm excited. I am beyond excited to have you here. So Patty, get your questions out. All right. Get your questions out. It's really, really important. Chris, what should I do when my pug bites? What corrections should be given? Chris, you've got to have an aversive. You've got to do something. First of all, how old is your pug? And tell me when it bites. And tell me what you're doing that is not working. Let's start with that. All right. So, Chris, I'm going to get back to you, and you can answer those questions, and you can write them in. I'm going to do a poll. The polls worked out really great. I'll try to come up with a poll. The reason why we're doing it at 9 o'clock is because the poll was overwhelmingly 9 o'clock won by 94% or something. Diana is sitting next to me. She's casually sipping wine, and I don't know how many of these she's going to do, but she keeps popping up on Mondays and Wednesday nights, and she's here for 2 months, and she's an intern from Omaha, Nebraska, and we're setting her up to actually open up her own dog training business. She's going to be spending 2 months with me, and we're going to promote the heck out of her, because if you're within 200 miles of Omaha, Nebraska, the Omaha dog chick is which I'm calling her, and whether she uses that name or not, I actually think, and I'm girl power all the way. I'm thinking Omaha dog chick might be a really cool name for her. Hey, who should train my dog? Hey, you better call the Omaha dog chick. I don't know. God, my dog's been biting me. Get a hold of the Omaha dog chick. We're throwing it around. Terry says, do you remember your tools? Yes, I did. I brought my bonker with me right here. So I've got that, and I've got a remote collar with me. But thank you. I got a lot of emails on that. Terry says, I have a dressage whip. I'm not sure if this is a bedroom or a dog training question. Hold on here, Terry. I didn't think they talked about these things in Utah. I have a dressage whip that's approximately 46 inches. Is that too short? Well, you're asking a guy, right? So no, it's long enough, right? Maybe we should get some women's opinions on that. Hey, Curtis and Meredith. Yes. So 46 inches. No. How long is the drop on that? So the drop on that. So I think ours are probably 65 feet, probably 5 foot tall, and we've got a 12 inch drop on ours. Sarah says, congrats, Diana. She's super psyched. Curtis and Meredith say Omaha dog chick is awesome. There you go. That's really, really great. And there was actually a little video of Diana working Rupert, and Rupert is that human aggressive dog who bites at everything. And that's the first job we gave Diana was, hey, why don't you work with Rupert? He bites at anything. And she did really great. Jeff, Terry says, bad Jeff. I know, that's why I'm happily married. That's really great, Terry. So I think you're just, remember Terry, the dressage whip is for reach, right? So all that is an extension of your arms. So 46 inches is probably fine. It works. Use it for your socialization and see how it works. Patty, okay. I have a question for you. So here it is. I have a one-year-old golden whom is giving me issues. He understands and does place well, and I'm working on increasing the time of the place. Awesome. He forgets all commands at times. I've tried the bonker, but he takes the bonker and runs with it. Okay. So Patty, number one, get two bonkers. Right? So it happens. You throw one bonker and then they grab it, then you throw another bonker, or the bonker doesn't work. He doesn't forget the commands at times. He's too excited to listen to the commands. So whenever anybody says, my dog is stubborn, my dog is doesn't listen to me, or in your example, or I forgot the last part of it here. It's been a long day. And then, so what happened is, it's important though that you understand that you want to proof your dog. When the dog has a certain level of excitement, they don't listen, right? So the goal is to do repetition, and work your dog under threshold and do lots of it. That's why I'm a big fan of remote cowers, because remote cowers can whisper and shout, but my energy can stay calm. So instead of yelling at your dog, I can use a remote cower to yell, but I can stay calm. Remember, dogs want to follow calm leaders. They don't like frantic. They don't like yelling. They don't like screaming. So a good example is, how many times have you seen a dog that's like really, really frantic and another dog runs over and gives that dog a prey bite? They're correcting the dog. They're acting as the sheriff. So what I want you to do, I want you to be able to work on basic commands, put your dog back on a leash, back on the prong collar, and work your dog through those distractions. So remember the three D's: you've got distraction, duration, and distance. So once the dog starts going over threshold, a lot of that goes out the window. So it's not that your dog doesn't know. It's not that your dog doesn't listen. It's your dog that doesn't hear. Does that make sense? So if we're at a cocktail party together, Patty, then you're across the room and it's really crowded and I'm saying, hey, Patty, what do you want to drink? And you're not even looking at me and you're engaged with somebody else. I'm like, God, Patty's being rude. You're not being rude. You just don't hear me. So what I would do is, that's the great thing about a remote collar. A remote collar is a 50-foot arm that would tap you on the shoulder. You would turn around and then I would say, Patty, what do you want? You tell me. So it's not that you didn't, it's not that you weren't paying attention. Peter says he was able to log in an iPad instead of laptop. Great. So I guess what happened was, Peter, he's like my most awesome client. He's so dedicated. I actually accidentally banned him last week, and I don't know how to unban him. So when I want to delete a comment, the ban button is right next to deleting the comment. So silly me, bad me, shame on me. I'm gonna pay more attention. So Peter, it's great to have you here. I'm so excited. I'm gonna go on to YouTube, or I'm gonna ask the administrator of Google Hangouts or Webinar Jam to how to fix that. Excellent. Doug H, we need to mark our chat or question to admin only so everyone will not have them rolling by. I believe I've got, let me see here, enable chat box. All messages are private. Okay, nope, you're all set. Everybody's private now. Okay. Okay. Wow, a lot of questions. Okay, hold on here. Bree, I have a question about the take it command. How do you go about training a dog to take things in its mouth? Where I went to school, we had take it battles, and I feel it isn't as effective as it's supposed to be. Okay. I don't teach take it. Take it is, if you do a forced retrieve or a forced fetch, you can teach take it. But what I do is I teach really good out. And then I've done is to engage a dog in tug. I can activate them to tug the toy. So I do out. I actually don't use the word leave it. I use out, and out means whatever is in your mouth, you spit it out of your mouth, or you immediately go to a soft mouth and you release it. So I imagine the training for that, the opposite of that would be take it. So what I would do is I would actually get a toy, a tug toy that the dog really, really, really loves. And this would be a good question for somebody that does a lot of probably a Shih Tzu person, because they do that with the wooden barbells, the wooden dumbbells. You probably can find a great video online on how to teach take it, or on forced retrieve or forced fetch. You can probably do that. What I do is with a girl, I just gave her I give her a bite command, and I use that in some, I give her bite commands for fun. It's the same command that I would use in protection work, even though I don't teach protection work. So I would do that. Okay, that's Bree. Thank you so much. Jeff, do you have any tips for blind handlers when it comes to training dogs? So the handler is blind. What I suggest you do is I suggest the dog goes into a boarding train, and you train that dog extremely well. And then what you can do is you can put a very small bell on the dog's collar, so the handler knows where the dog is at all times. And I would remote collar train that dog. And how can we know if that dog is in a sit, a down, or in place? I am not blind, but I know that folks that are visually impaired or blind have really great senses as far as their hearing and their smell. So, and eventually they can just use their hands for touching the dog. So if it's a larger dog, it probably would be easier. I would actually train that dog to do touch. It means the dog has to come up to you on recall. And so the biggest things would be recall. So I call the dog over. It doesn't matter where the dog is. So in other words, if my dogs are in my play yard, which is in the front of my house, and I'm in the back of my house, and I yell here, I can care less where they're coming from as long as they come to me. So theoretically, I'm doing a blind recall. As far as healing the dog, I can close my eyes and heal a dog. In fact, I don't want to look at my dog, but I want to know where my dog is. How do I do that? Because I can feel it in the leash. So I've got great, well, actually my vision is really bad. I'm actually going in for new lenses. I'm going to drop them off. It takes 2 hours. It's crazy. So I'll see if I can find an old pair. So what I know is, though, is I like to close my eyes and I like to feel where the dog is. So that's what I would do. Okay. Okay. Getting through your questions. Doug, so you don't have to mark them private. They all should be coming through private right now. Okay. Patty says, I have a question for you. So here it is. Okay. Thanks for the intro. Good job, Patty. I have a one-year-old Golden whom is giving me issues. All right. Sounds right. He understands and does place well. We already did that. So I would remote collar train that dog. So Patty, remote collar train the dog. Remote collar train the dog, because then your word no has meaning to it. All right. Amy says, first of all, welcome everybody. Welcome. There's a lot of people in here, and I can't thank enough for folks for coming and attending my webinar. Hello, Vanessa, how are you? How are you doing? You're very special, and I'm glad you're here. Amy says, I own a fearful Afghan hound, mainly with men, no aggression. Am I best to hand him off to a male trainer, or do you have suggestions for me to help him get through this? Yes, I do. It all depends on the male trainer, first of all. So, right? So trainer can make things better, trainer can make things worse. What I would do, though, is, Amy, do you follow me on Facebook? If you do, what I want you to do is I want you to look at the video from yesterday. I'm going to be adding a bunch of new things to this, to my webinar. By next week, I'll be able to play a video right in the box here. So I'll be able to play a video right in the box. So I was playing around with it today. Look what I got today here. Just be, you know, bear with me here. Bear with me. I'm trying to make this. Oh, I can't do it. Once I started, I can't do it. I can't do my, oh, there we go. So check it out. Check it out, right? Huh? Cool. What do you think? Now, when I did that, did my screen go smaller? Like, are you seeing less of me? Because I'm seeing less of me. So I don't know if I like that. Not that I want to see more of me. All right. So anyway, let me go back to the questions. Bree, thanks for the answer. You're welcome. So what I would do is, Amy, look at the video that I did with my three kids and that little dog who has fear issues around children, and how I did that. That feeding protocol. What I want you to do is I want you to watch that. And what we do is we back tie the dog, and then we put food down in front of the dog, out of reach of the dog. The dog is extremely hungry. Then we'll line up a bunch of men. And what we'll do is the dog sees the food, can't get to the food. The dog is really hungry. So men will kneel down, or they'll sit in a chair. And what they'll do is they'll reach down. Patty says, pretty cool. I thought that was cool, huh? And Sarah says, nope, same size for me. Okay, cool. So that was just on my end. I thought that was pretty cool that you can, like, the What Would Jeff Do show at the bottom, and I can do some other overlays. So we might be doing some fun stuff here. We might be doing some fun stuff. The response has been really great to these webinars, and right now I'm hooked and addicted on them. And the reason why I'm doing these webinars is because we're killing 4 million dogs a year, and I've decided to do – I had this vision of doing 5 a week plus my radio show. But I got a letter from my wife's lawyer. So what we did was we're going to do 2 in the radio show. So we're going to do it on Mondays and Wednesdays only. Mondays and Wednesdays from 9 o'clock. And I can do them from anywhere in the world as long as I've got an internet connection. So I'm looking really, really great. Vanessa, that's great. I'm so happy for you. You're doing great. Okay. So that's what I want you to do. I want you to do the food protocol with that dog. So all these people will come up. They'll hold their hand out. There's food in it. The dog sniffs. And as soon as the dog backs away from the sniffing, they open up their hand and they say, good. Watch the video with my 3 children. I think it's called Aggressive Dog with Kids or something like that. Okay. It's on the top of the screen of you in the lower left corner. So it just covers your jacket. Okay, Terry. Yes, it does. It does. It's called, so Terry, that thing that I just put up, it's called the bottom third. So it takes a third of the screen away. But for some reason, my screen, like, all of a sudden, like, shrunk. Okay. Patty says, do you have any suggestions on how we can get ourselves in the calm state when the dog does something incorrectly? Practice, 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 practice. Even when I'm getting attacked, if anybody has ever seen any videos of me being lunged at in the face by dogs, you'll see that I barely flinch, or sometimes I don't even flinch. So a dog's on a back tie, one just for my face, and I just go. There's a great video from Phoenix, Arizona. It's called The Face Biting Dog, and this is the cool thing right now. Like I can say, you know, Diana, cue that one up, and then she'd find it, and we'd cue it up. So all this stuff I talk about, think about that. Everything we talk about, we like, they're like, oh, I want to show the video from yesterday. You can have it queued up on the side, and then you can just boom, you put it right up there. How cool would that be? Let's figure that out. We're gonna figure that out. Push you to make extra money. There you go. So that was really great. And you get to drink, and you can drink wine at the same time. Right. So Diana's sitting here drinking wine. So I can go to Jeff's house, drink wine, and like play around on YouTube and make extra money. Like, okay, great. So she's all in. She's like a super cool chick. All right. So Patty, you got to work with lots of dogs. All right. So the great thing about every correction has to be fair and calm. Every correction has to be fair and calm. If you lose your cool, actually, this one is not going to be on AM790. If you lose your shit, dog's going to go, I'll listen to you, but I don't trust you. Does that make sense? So for any of you, trust me, I've been a total jerk at work. I've yelled at employees before, and I've been a total jerk. That's not my management style. But the thing is that my employees will listen to me. Why? They have to. I'm the boss. But if I'm a real jerk to them, and if I'm yelling at them, they'll listen to me. But I guess, you know what else they're doing? They're looking for another job. If I sit down and I talk to my employees about something fair that they've done incorrectly and I explain it to them, they'll say to themselves, wow, what a great boss. And I understand. And thank you so much for bringing it to my attention. So you can correct. Remember, the word no is education. Okay, the word no is positive. I look at all training as positive. Even telling a dog no is a positive thing. All right, we're getting slammed with questions. This is great. This is wonderful. Okay, I'm going to delete some questions here, or else I can't see it. Doug, I see your question. Okay, Amy, I own a fearful Afghan. Oh, we already answered that one. Hopefully, Amy, that was helpful. Peter, Jeff, do you have any rules for your children's friends that come over and want to pet the dog or maybe don't know about personal space, like getting too close or putting their face right in the dog? Great question, Peter. Nobody pets my dogs. All right. So Peter asked a really great question. Nobody pets my dogs. Why? I don't trust people. That is why. So I've got a lot of dogs. Some of my dogs live on at work. Some of my dogs live at home. We've got an in-ground pool. If anybody goes back to last summer, you'll see that there's like 15 or 20 dogs that are swimming in my pool with my kids. My children don't pet dogs. Okay. I don't let adults or children touch my dogs. They're not going to bite them. I don't want people petting my dogs. Why? I want to be everything to my dogs. I don't want my dogs, to be focused on anything but me. So Sarah says, I flinch so bad. I really need to work on that. So you do, Sarah, you do. I know you can't. You show weakness in a dog. Your average dog goes, I gotcha. I'm going to manipulate the heck out of you, Sarah. Dogs are really, really intelligent. They're really intelligent. All right. I mean, I've been mauled 3 times. I've been hospitalized before. And every once in a while, I'll still have some PTSD flashbacks of the mauling. So I got to really keep my energy in check. All right. I really got to keep my energy in check. All right, Sarah. But Sarah, okay. Let me tell you something, Sarah. Just because you're flinching, just because your confidence is low, I want you to know you still have value as a dog trainer. I'm telling you, you still do. So don't you dare let that stop you. There are families out there that need you. Okay? You got to remember, your average family, if you can get their dog to stop pulling on a leash, they will love you. Stop jumping. Stop barking. Dealing with separation anxiety. Housebreaking. Sit down. Place. I'm telling you, you never have to work with an aggressive dog. Ever. Okay? You never have to. There's not a lot of people that work with the level of aggression that we do, right? You don't need to. Okay. So that answered that question, Peter. Peter, I'm gonna make sure I don't ban you from my webinars. I've actually never banned anybody from my webinars here. They've got to stop. Maybe I should, like, why are they making the ban button and the shrink button the same? Sharon. Doug, I'll get to your question, Doug. Doug says, can you talk about redirected aggression, whether you can see it coming before you get bitten? I can see it, but I wouldn't call it aggression. I would call it redirected energy or redirected biting. I'm pretty good. It's been a really long time since I've been bitten the leg, bitten the arm, I've never been bitten the face. What Doug is talking about, if you're not familiar with redirected aggression, it's when it's all about energy, folks. Everything is energy, right? So that's why we need to control the dog's energy. So say you've got a leash reactive dog, and it's always lunge forward, bark, 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 lunge forward, bark, bark, bark. What happens is when it can't do that anymore, it has to do something with that energy. It has to do something. What does it do? Sometimes it turns on its handler and it bites your leg. It's a common thing to have your leg bitten or your arm bitten. But I'm really quick, and we do we pull the dog out like that. So it's called the bow and arrow. Where imagine you're pulling back a bow and arrow, but you're not using the pullback hand, but your arm, you're walking your dog, and all of a sudden your arm just goes like that, straight out. My arm goes out about a yard, and for my European folks, that's about a meter, okay? So, but I can tell. I can sense it, right? You should be able to sense it. You should be able to feel it. And when you work with enough dogs, you just have that feeling. You're like, you're going to bite me. So what do? You actually correct the dog for thinking that. Remember, a lot of what I talk about is we talk about corrections. Corrections are fair, corrections are firm, corrections are timely, and corrections are education. And in my opinion, corrections are very positive. Okay, why? Because I'm keeping you from doing that bad behavior again. Sorry, badly behaved dogs don't live long. Okay, biting dogs don't live long. This fantasy that you know, when you guys were growing up, I don't know what the age bracket here is, but when you guys were growing up and your parents said that the dog, oh, we found a good dog, we found a good home for the dog, it's on a farm somewhere, the dog's dead. Guys, your parents killed the dog. Okay, they took it to the vet and they killed it. Or in some parts of the country, they took it in the back and they shot it. Okay, back then, dogs didn't bite more than once. Right? I'm sure someone's going to say, no, we had a dog that bit me 5 times. Of course you did. But most dogs don't bite more than once back in the day. All right. Sharon, hold on. I got to. Okay. Apple cider vinegar, honey, and water. 3 times a day. That's why I have this. I'll be 50 next year. That's why I have this youthful glow. All right. Yeah. All right. Patty says, okay, thanks. I'm trying and we'll try harder. It makes sense and I'll get a lot of practice with mine. Good job, Patty. Good job. I'm proud of you. Bree, oh, Bree, I already answered you. I'm going to get back to you, Bree. You can ask more than one question, but gosh, I wish my chat screen wasn't so small. If it's like one question in there and I got to scroll down. Sharon, hey, Sharon. Shoot, I just lost you. So, Sharon, I have a white German Shepherd who is very good on leash outside, likes other dogs, is fine with people, and at home is obedient and knows basic commands. Awesome. But, aha, the but. Inside the house, if someone comes in the house, his fearful nature takes hold and he doesn't hear anything I say, but he hides under the dining room table. That's not good, and barks and growls. Funny, for 6 months after I rescued him, he never barked and only hid when people came in. Okay, so what your dog is doing is he didn't bark because that was sort of the honeymoon period. So what I want you to do is this. Your dog is having a fear reaction, which is really interesting that he's so, I wouldn't be surprised if there was other signs of fear that maybe you're not recognizing. So what I want you to do is I want you to teach your dog the place command, the place command. First of all, you got to stop that barking. The barking is nonsense. Okay. I don't allow barking except for one dog on the property. So I do have a protection dog that lives on my property. He lives outside. He has obviously a heated dog house. Everyone thinks that a dog living outside is mean. It's like, he's not living outside underneath 2 feet of snow. He's not out there in 0 degree temperature. His dog house today was 53 degrees and it's what, 10 degrees. Well, today was 40. But he's got a heater and a heating pad. Anyway, that's not the point. The point is that, so many dogs in this country live outside. It's incredible. We're not talking about chained to a tree. We're talking about 2,500 square foot of yard to watch over. So anyway, so what I want you to do is I want you to teach place. I've got a good video on the place command. So the place command is I want your dog to go to a mat. Now, when you're going to send the dog to the mat, the dog is going to probably start shaking. Okay? Why? Energy. Normally they would go underneath the table and bark. When a dog is barking, you don't see it shaking as much. So you have to shut the barking up and you put the dog in place. How do you shut the barking up? With the word no that has meaning to it. So how do you do that? With a leash pop, with a remote collar, with a bonker. If anyone doesn't know what a bonker is, this is a bonker. Gary Wilkes, watch the video. This is a towel wrapped up. I just put some hair elastics around it really quick. What do? With a bonker, if the dog was barking, you can take the bonker, throw it at the dog. It'll hit him in the head. It'll hit him in the side. Dogs hate projectiles. They hate projectiles. You won't hurt the dog. Now, will the dog exhibit a fear response? Probably. Guess what? Your dog is exhibiting a fear response anyway. Who cares? Sorry. You can use fear to fight fear. You actually can. All right? Fear is not a bad thing, right? Fear keeps us alive. Correct? Why do we show up for work on time? We're afraid we'll get fired. Why do we drive safely? We're afraid we'll get into a car accident. Why do we not jump in front of buses? We're afraid we'll be dead. So, right? Fear is not a bad thing. Fear keeps us alive. So animals survive in the wild because of fear. So that's what I want you to do is teach your dog place. Keep the dog on place. You might start seeing some shaking. Why? The dog's energy is unbalanced. Dogs eventually should not shake. All right? Peter says, also this week, I tell my dog to play tug. Peter, I'm so in love with that. That's really great. Peter says, thanks, Jeff. Can I switch from kibble to Volhard raw cold turkey, or do I need to transition over, say, a week? They say transition over a week. I do things cold turkey. All right? I do things cold turkey. Okay? I went from a drinker to a non-drinker in one day over 20 years ago. All right? Sunday brunch, Las Vegas. I was at a trade show. It was $12.95, Tropicana Hotel. The night before, I had one beer. That morning, it came with a champagne brunch. I said to myself, I'm never going to drink again. Haven't had a drop since. So, it doesn't take long to give up smoking. It doesn't take long to give up alcohol. It doesn't long to give up coffee. It doesn't take long at all. All right. It takes 1 second to do it. It's all the stuff that leading up to it to do it. But that has nothing to do about raw food. But that was my little positive motivational speech. And I wanted to get that in there. So what I want you to do is you can do half and half. I think the packaging says half and half. Read the packaging. Go buy the packaging. Wendy Volhard is amazing. Brittany says, hi, Jeff. Just remembering to join it. Hello, Brittany. We've been waiting for you. Everybody was talking. Okay. Brittany's here. Nobody talk about her anymore. Amy says, thanks for answering my question, Jeff. I'll definitely watch the video. I saw the post on Facebook yesterday, but didn't get a chance to watch it. Amy, you're scrolling through my posts and you're not watching. What do you think I put them up there for? Come on. It's a good post, actually. Okay. Let's see. Sharon, did I answer your question? Yeah, I've answered your question. All right. Okay. Bree says, get your questions, guys. Get your questions. It's all for you. Bree says, I've been training a dog that is a Basenji Beagle mix that is really high tolerance with an e-collar, and I have him on a dog trail 1900, and I keep turning the dial up, and he just sits there and takes the corrections. I've never turned it up to 127 for biting, and he still will try to go after me or keep doing what he was doing through the correction. I've checked where the fit in the collar is working. He's just taking those corrections like it's nothing. What should I do? All right. So Bree, I can't answer your question online. All right. Bree, you're going to have to private message me, or you're going to have to give me a Skype session. All right. I can't, because I don't want to. Okay. I can't. You've got a biting dog that's attacking you, and we have ways to fix that that take about 15 seconds, and the dog should never bite again. We're not using physical force. I'm not kicking or hitting the dog, but you need to get the conversation through to the dog because he's a safety risk. So dogs can blow through remote. What I would say is I would switch to a dominant dog collar. So I would switch to a dominant dog collar. And if you know what they are, you can go to Leerburg, Leerburg.com. Look up dominant dog collar. If you're a trainer, you can buy them from a woman named Leslie Pierney. She's over in Cape Cod, canine leashes and collars, I think. She does not call them dominant dog collars, though, but look to see what they are. We carry them as well. You might want to private message me or set up a Skype visit to know my protocols for aggression rehab, or you would do a shadow program. I rarely talk publicly about how we do true aggression, and not because I'm afraid of any criticism, because I get criticized every day, but I think it's important that it is done in a specific way that's well-timed. And when we're talking about aggression, we're talking about life and death of the dog, as well as personal safety of children, adults, and yourself. So, but there's a way you can fix it. I just want you to know that, but look at dominant dog collars. Chris says, are bonkers okay with small dogs? Absolutely. Behavior is behavior is behavior. Now, so I've got a Chihuahua. Two Chihuahuas that are what, 6 pounds? Would I use a bonker this size? Probably. It's a towel. All this is a towel. But you can go with a smaller one if you want to. But yes, bonkers are okay with all dogs, as long as they're breathing. If they're not breathing, it's not going to help you anyway. But yes. Terry says, do you have a favorite treat or food bag? I call them food bags because I don't use treats. But yeah, there's the one that, Yes, I do. We just bought them on Amazon. I got four of them. They were $12.95. They're the ones that stay open automatically and then snap back. I don't know the name of it, though. But yes, I do. And we wear them. Remind me to take a photo of it tomorrow. I'll put a photo up, Terry. I'll tell you what, Terry, email me, and then I will email you the photo back. How's that? Okay. So Chris, bonkers, okay, small dogs. Yes. Bree, okay, thank you. Do I message you on Facebook? Yes, you would message me on Facebook. If you want to do a Skype session, you fill out a application on my training contract, and it's well worth it. It really is. It's well worth it. I do a lot of Skype aggression consults all around the world. All around the world. I do 2 to 3 Skype visits a day. Okay. Okay. Sorry, I just want to breathe here. I'm going to go through some of these. So Doug H asked, tell us why playing tug with a dog is beneficial to the dog. Mike Ellis advocates it and has a DVD featuring how it helps. Well, then you know, Doug. You watch the DVD. Okay. So listen to Michael Ellis. He's probably got a better explanation, you know, than I do. I've just started playing tug with dogs. So to me, tug is a great activity to do with a dog. It builds a really great bond. It teaches them more about mouth control. It teaches them when they can bite, when they can't bite. It's a lot of fun for the dog. It teaches a lot of impulse control. So I don't know what Michael Ellis says, but I imagine if you got the video, you'd find out. Does that one pop open? Okay. So Terry, the Guardian Gear dog training treat bag in blue. Guardian Gear. It says Terylene. I don't know. Terylene. Maybe that's the fabric. Dog training treat bag. It's a bag that pops open. It pops open and then pops closed. All right. Janine asks, Jeff, when you first started out or when you teach others that are first starting out as trainers, is it common to get frustrated with dogs that are fighting the process? Of course it is. It still can be frustrating, right? Okay. Janine, if a dog is not responding to you, whose fault is it? Right? Whose fault is it? Lose the ego. I got a huge one. Lose the ego. Whose fault is it, Janine? Yours. Okay. You're not communicating with the dog. Okay. You're not communicating with the dog. So you say to yourself, this isn't working. What's going to work? That's why I'm a balanced trainer. I've got a lot of different tools in my toolbox. I try a lot of stuff because, you know, you got to figure out what motivates the dog, what motivates the dog. But if you want to make it really easy for you, just work on food drive at the beginning. You know, I never did that, but work on food drive. So get the dog really hungry. I assure you the dog will start patterning through the food. So only feed them when you train them, not treats. Do their daily food. So my biggest tools are food, remote collars, prong collars, dominant dog collars. That's where my balance comes in. That's where my balance comes in. Okay. All right, I'm back on the air. I do have no idea what just happened. I hope all of you don't have to log back in or not. But I know everybody lost me. My fingers are not working quick. So everyone might have to log back in. I know. Everybody lost me. I know. God, girl's got nasty gas. Video went off. I know. So now I got, I had so many great questions. I know. So I apologize for that. We got bumped off. Okay, great. Bree, you can see me again. Great. That's wonderful. I got bumped off. I have no idea what happened. I see you again. Good. I'm so sorry, guys. I'm so sorry. I have no idea what just happened. Okay, good. So your vocal is an echo. I don't know why that happened. Hopefully my voice will come back on. I found you good. So sorry, guys. Can you all log back in? I'm gonna have to it's not your end. On my end, I got bumped off. Yes, I'm back. So whoever has questions I did not answer, please answer. Okay, good. Everyone's coming back on. Good. Ask all your questions are gone. So if I did not answer your questions yet, if I didn't get to them, please ask your questions again. I apologize. That was definitely my error. My error. Gotta love technology. Actually, it's more incompetence of the user. It's not the technology. This is actually really good technology. This was me. So please ask your questions again. Back on, Michelle. Yep, I'm here. So it looks like everybody else is, you know, they're filtering back in. So that's really great. So if I didn't get a chance to ask your questions, the echo was from two sessions running at once. You still hear an echo? I only got one. Let me shut down some of my screens here. Nope, I only got one session. So maybe I wasn't, I don't know. Anyway, I'm back. Allison writes, hey, Jeff. I'm training a small dog with separation anxiety and have the e-collar on him and leave with Skype open. That's a good idea. He's doing well and doesn't bark, dig the door, chew the bars anymore. I was wondering if you think I should and when to move to a bark collar so I can move out of the e-collar range. He will test to see if the collar will correct him, and if there is no correction, he will start barking. Also, when can you get rid of bark collars and e-collars in general for separation anxiety? That's a really good question. I would, thank you, Allison. Allison says I sound good. So Allison, what I would do is I would switch to a bark collar if you're not around. So if the thing is about this, where the bark collar is, if a dog can't bark, historically they calm down. So that I would switch to a bark collar. That would be great to do. That would be great to do. I'd like to see you switch to a bark collar and see how it goes. The thing about remote collars with separation anxiety, a lot of people don't understand that. I've got a great video on YouTube. It's called You Go Underneath My Solid Canine Training Account. And you can get to that right from my website. And what it is you can look up separation anxiety, and it shows up, and it's like 13 ways of eliminating separation anxiety and preventing separation anxiety. And one of the things we talk about is remote collars. And the reason is this, because when a dog has separation anxiety, it's in its crate and it's trying to break out of its crate, or it's biting at the bars, or it's, you know, scampering like this, or it's barking, its head, if something is wrong with its head. So I want to, remote collars, you know, calm dogs down. They calm dogs down. We're talking about a low level. So if you're in the middle of a panic attack and all of a sudden someone put their hand on your shoulder and said, Jeff, I need you to relax, and you relax, that's what remote collars do. Okay. That's what they do. Okay. Remote collars are not shocking or zapping. They're not. Can we? Yeah, I can. But look what I can do, a lot with my hands. I can do a lot with my feet. I can do a lot with a leash. I can do a lot with a flat buckle collar. You can kill it. Everyone thinks flat buckle collars are kind. I can kill a dog with a flat buckle collar, right? I can kill a dog with a martingale. I can kill a dog with a gentle leader. So it's not the tool. It's how you're using the tool. So prong collars are really easy to use. Remote collars take a little bit. You know, I give the general public, you know, a lot of credit. You know, think about it. I mean, my clients are not idiots, right? So, you know, I got clients that are like a rocket scientist, a chef, which is a pretty smart person. You know, my clients are not, you know, idiots. You know, I've got videos where people remote collar train their dogs fully. So if anybody took the time and read, there's something, it's really great. There's something inside the box of a remote collar. It's called an owner's manual. It's there for a reason. Read it. It's not that difficult to train your dog on a remote collar, okay? Patty says, is that the name you were looking for? You must have 13, 15 aggression, fearful dog rehab, day one. Oh, I don't know. I'm not sure, Patty. I don't have those in front of me. I make so many videos. I was looking for a video today on my Facebook page. I must have 500 videos on my Facebook page. I couldn't find it. Vanessa says, I can't walk. Oh, shoot. Vanessa says, I can't walk both of my dogs together because Stitch is going crazy when she sees another dog on the street, and Caesar will go after her. And I struggle holding them apart with my two hands. How can I stop this? I want to walk them together one day. Vanessa, okay? You got to get me over there, all right? You got to get me over there. You got, we got Stitch is causing you problems now. So what Caesar is doing is Caesar is correcting Stitch. Does that make sense? Because it's your job to correct Stitch. So we talked about tools. We talked about healing protocols, but you got to keep those dogs both calm on the walk. So what's happening is Stitch is getting all escalated. And then let me make sure that I've got my settings. Yep, I got my settings right. Stitch is getting all agitated. And then what does Caesar do? Hey, Vanessa ain't helping this situation here. Guess what? Boom, Caesar steps up. Why? As we've discussed, Caesar's an aggressive dog. So the goal is you should be able to walk them both together in the same hand while you're holding a cup of coffee, a cup of espresso, right? God, how do I used to be able to, when I went to Germany, I ordered a ton of coffee. I knew was ist das, like pointing to something. And if it sounded like they said chicken, I would order it. Okay, so that's how you can do, Vanessa. Debbie says, my German Shepherd hates for me to put her collar on. Any kind of collar, it's always a fight. Also not sure where to place her prong collar because of the bushy hair around. Okay, Debbie, I made a video. Okay, I don't know if you're new to me or not, Debbie, but if you are, I love you and thank you so much. I haven't seen your name before. Thank you so much for joining my webinars. Get onto my Facebook page. I put up new videos every single day. There's a video of Rupert. Go back. Rupert's been with me he's been with me 2 weeks today. So go back to about 2 weeks ago. You want to find a video of Rupert. He's actually on my YouTube channel as well. It's called Collar Conditioning an Aggressive Dog. Any collar putting on that dog, what would happen is this. He would attack. He touches paws, attack. Get the towel out, attack. I show you exactly how we do this. I show the same protocol that I would use on your dog. It's all going to be food. I actually never had to correct him. It's all going to be food-based, okay? You're going to use his daily food, not treats. Okay, you're not rewarding him with a treat for doing something. You're using his hunger drive and his food drive to do this. So if you want to eat today, guess what? That collar is going on, but I show you how to do it literally step by step by step. All right? I did this with a highly, highly aggressive dog. So I want you to do that. All right? Prong collar goes up high on the neck like this. So if you say to yourself, Debbie, that looks too high, it's right. And it should be super snug. If you say to yourself, that seems a little bit snug, it's correct. I've got a video on that. I'm going to make another video. You know what, Diana? Let's do some videos this week. You know why? Because I'll make the videos and you make them too. So you'll start making videos too on like the basic stuff. All right? So then you'll have your own videos. Diana, she's my intern. She's sitting right next to me drinking, almost the whole bottle of wine. There's Diana sitting next to me. There's Diana on the floor. Jeff's wife comes home. What's Diana doing in your office on the floor? We're doing a webinar, hon. We're doing a webinar. Oh, is that what you call it? A webinar, huh? Hey, you know what? The great thing is I got a super, super cool wife. She wouldn't care if Diana was drunk on my floor. Okay. Okay. Hold on. So does that answer your question, Debbie? And if it is your first time here, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Let's see. Doug H, do different breeds bite and withdraw versus bite and hold on? No. All breeds will do both. All breeds will do both. Okay. Bite and hold on, a little bit more concerned. Bite and withdraw, that's usually a fear bite. Bite and hold on, that's usually a practice bite that I'm more concerned with on the dog. I work with both. So I work with dog killers. I work with human maulers. And a lot of people say, well, those dogs shouldn't be alive. Possibly true, but give them to a good balanced trainer and let's see how far we can go, right? Let me make that decision. And I've only been dog training for 10 years, but I've trained about 3,000 dogs and I work with a lot of difficult dogs. 4 times I've recommended or agreed with killing the dog. 4 times. And I would say 50% of the dogs that I work with have been recommended to be killed. So I think I'm doing okay on that. Okay. Lauren says, thanks to Debbie for that question. It was mine as well. Yeah, I've got a great protocol on collar conditioning. Terry says, what are the ratios for your apple vinegar? Terry, this isn't a cooking show. All right. What's that called? What's bar drink called? Making drinks. What's it called? Mixology. This is not a mixology show. What do? Okay. If I make it, this is what I do. I fill this up with water. I take the big thing of apple cider vinegar. I go 1, 2, boom. And I take the honey and I go 1, 2, boom. Linda, she gets the measurements out. You got to see her. She measures everything. You got to see her when she's making, when three kids need beverages, she puts the cups all lined up. Every kid has the exact amount of beverage. So Linda knows that stuff. All right. Don't ever ask me to bake anything because it won't work because I'm not good. I don't do the ratios. Allison says, hey, Jeff, may I ask a question dealing with a small dog with a separation anxiety? I'm sorry, but it told me I no longer had access to your webinar. So I jumped to another computer. You did. I got bumped off. I was wondering if you could give me the summary of what you said. I'm sorry. Oh, shoot. I don't remember the question. Separation anxiety is there's, I've got a great video on 13 ways to fix and or prevent it. And I want people to do every single thing. Remember, more than 50%, 50% of the dogs that we get in have separation anxiety on their intake forms. Guess what? None of them have it after 24 hours of my property. None of them. Got it? Okay. Separation anxiety is reinforced with reinforced from the owner. I'm telling you. So watch that video. Do everything. Okay. If there's everything, and Vanessa knows this better than me, right, Vanessa? Things that are difficult, if you don't do them, you won't see the results. If you only pick the easy stuff, right? If you only pick the easy stuff, guess what? You're not going to see success. So this morning I do I got a treadmill right over next to me. So when I do my treadmill, push-ups, and then core work, guess what? When I feel like quitting, I do another 25 push-ups. I do another 2 minutes of planking, right? Because it's the 25 extra push-ups and the 2 minutes of planking that are going to make the difference. That's the hard stuff, okay? If my workout was just easy, I wouldn't see progress. So if I stopped it easy, no progress. You got to go past easy into hard. All right. Debbie says, I'm new here. Thank you. And I look forward to, I will look for the videos. Love from Mississippi. Awesome. Awesome. And I want to thank you, Debbie, so much. I'll actually be down. I know it's not Mississippi, but I'll be down in my RV dog trainer seminar down in Gainesville, Florida. And people from Mississippi do travel there. At least the ones that get permission from the probation officer. So what I want you to do is go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, and you'll see my seminar schedule. Awesome, Debbie. Thank you. I love you. You're so great. Brittany says, my daughter has separation anxiety. Oh, your daughter? Even with me in the same room, she screams at me if I don't pay attention to her. Brittany. Okay, you want parenting advice? Okay, I got 7 kids. So ever since when my kids were young, this is the routine. Get in that room and play. Get in that room and play. All my kids can go to a room, even Angelo. Angelo, go play with your toys. Okay, goes and plays with his toys. He leaves us alone. Okay, so good one, Brittany, though. Oh, shoot. I almost banned her. That's how I'm banning people. I didn't. I deleted you. Jeez. Hold on, I got a lot of questions here. Sarah says, I really like the video you did on the e-collar out of the box. I watched it 3 times and read the manual at the same time. Awesome. Sarah, that's a great video. She's referring to the video on the e-collar technologies mini educator. And it's literally, here's your box, open it up. E-collar technologies actually uses that as one of their videos. I'm drinking my unmeasured, I'm going to have to actually, you have to fill that up for me. I'm sending you out for, right. All right. Okay. Gosh, guys, this is going to go longer than I thought. It's 9:55. Okay. Curtis and Meredith says, you two are the best parents. Curtis and Meredith, if you had kids, you'd be the best parents. You know. Curtis and Meredith, did I send you an email? Guess where we went on Saturday? We went to Cheesecake Factory. We used your gift certificate. Thank you so much. It was so awesome. It was fantastic. So we did the radio show. And after the radio show, we picked up the kids. We went to the mall because I had to go to the Apple store. I can't stand malls. But that's where Cheesecake Factory is, and that's where the Apple store is. So we went to the mall. We went to Cheesecake Factory. fantastic. All of the family, it was fantastic. And then I went to the Apple store because I had to learn how to export 100,000 photos onto my 2 terabyte drive. So Vanessa says true words, Jeff. So thank you so much, Curtis and Meredith. You guys are awesome. Let's see. Oh my gosh, this is great. So many questions. Thank you so much, guys. I love you. You guys are awesome. Allison says, hey, Jeff, I'm training a small dog with separate. Oh, we just did that. Oh, then there was the Allison about the question. Oh, go to the bark collar. I just go to a bark collar. Usually when a dog can't bark, they tend to have less separation anxiety. Janine says, I trained my own boxer mixed with snotty, bready behavior fairly quickly with the help of 3 training sessions with Dave Caramico. Awesome. He's out in Phoenix, Arizona, right on the outskirts of Phoenix. He was a quick learner and compliant with all training. That's awesome. He's an amazing and obedient dog now. I'm fostering now and my fosters are, fostering now and my fosters are fighting me, but I'm limiting on the tools I can use because of the rescue rules. So I'm starting to become frustrated. Wrong rescue. Janine, why do you want to struggle? Take them back to the rescue. Say, you train them. Got it? Got it? 3 dogs. You can't use the tools you want. Take them back. Goodbye. Find another rescue that you can use your tools. All right? I'm non-negotiable when it comes to my tools. I'm non-negotiable. All right? I got a couple of pipe leaks in my building right now. I call up a plumber. Plumber comes here. He comes in with a bunch of toolboxes. Guess what I say? I need that fixed. I could care less how he does it. Fix my leak. You know what? I don't like that tool. I don't like the look of that tool. You're going to put that on my pipes? No. You're not allowed to bring that tool in here. Come on now. No. I know we're talking about dogs. Bottom line is you train the way you train or you send the dogs back. Bottom line, if they want those dogs to die because of some ideology they have that doesn't even work, the hell with them. Let them be responsible. Okay, it's the stupidest thing in the world. Stupidest thing. You think living in a cage 24 hours a day, spinning around, waiting to get killed is positive? Bullshit. Okay? How many times do you walk into a shelter system? You got dogs jumping and barking and I can fix that in 30 seconds or less. I can fix a dog from barking and rushing out of a kennel in 30 seconds with no tools at all. Every dog should be off-leash trained that lives in a shelter for more than a month. Wrong play. Janine, stop wasting your time. Forget the shelter. Find a rescue that you can do anything you want. Jill says, how would you train a dog straight to e-collar for basic obedience? No preset work with a prong collar. That's fine in leash pressure. For example, teaching a sit, you use leash pressure upwards where the dog goes into an automatic sit. With the e-collars, you don't have the upwards pressure, only pressure. He's a 6-month-old pit puppy, and the owner does not want to use a prong collar or use neck pressure with collars, and he's only trained with an e-collar before with an already trained dog. He's my first board and train ever, and I cannot wait. He comes Saturday. Okay, Jill, awesome. Number one, though, Jill. You took a client on that you can't do what you want to do. Wrong client. I'm not trying to ruin your celebration here. I love the fact that you got a board and trained dog, all right? But your business, your training, you do what you want. Got it? So you tell the client that's not what you do. The dog doesn't want neck pressure. Why not? What? He's going to hurt the dog's neck? You're not going to hurt the dog's neck. This is what you do. Tell him you don't want that dog Saturday. You got 3 days. Tell him you want that dog on half rations. Okay. You want that dog on half rations. That's it. Okay. And then the dog only eats when it works. So what do? You do watch here again. Watch my video. Watch the video that I put up yesterday with my kids. With the little dog that was on a tie back. So what you do with it, you just use all food. So you know that if you hold the food up, the dog's gonna sit. So you do food, remote. You get a hungry dog, it's gonna come running to you. Remote, give it food, remote. So you're gonna do come, sit, break. Look at one of my videos that I show, come, sit, break. Dog comes to you, it sits, take the food, throw it off to the side. When the dog is eating the food, you move away from it, call it again, all with remote collar conditioning. But a basic thing, Jill, you don't want to talk about. If you've got time, Jill, you might want to go to our T3 Accelerate program. Go to Train the Trainers with Sean and Jeff. We have a T3 Accelerate. It's down in New Orleans, Louisiana. It's only $500. It's half price. Remember, our T3 program is $3,500. There's 6 days coming up. So you want to find the perfect client. That's not the right client for you, right? I know you're excited. I'm excited for you. But think about that. You're going to get frustrated. The client is dictating to you how to use it, right? You don't let clients do that to you. It's the wrong client. Do you know how many people don't like how I train? I mean, tons of people hate how I train. Guess what though? They don't hire me, and I won't let them hire. I won't let them hire me. I use what I use. So, okay. Peter asks, how do you know if your dog is balanced and sees you as the pack leader? Peter, if you gotta ask, your dog ain't balanced. That was a good one, huh? Peter, I shut you up pretty quick, huh? I love you, man. I really do. I love you. Is that the same Peter that's single looking for an apartment? I got a really great guy out there, ladies. He's single, good job, dog lover. And he's like, he's a really nice guy. And I think he's single. He's good. He's a good guy. Bree says, hold on. That's for buying him, going on the gift certificates. Now you didn't, I'm glad I enjoyed it. Yep. We loved it. We loved it. It was good. Oh my gosh. Allison says you answered it right as I posted it. Okay. Are you? I won't ignore you, but I'll delete the question. Doug says, thank you for saying all that about rescue. Doug, you are welcome. You're welcome. Sorry, guys. Okay. I'm sorry. Rescue, no disrespect. Rescue people are hard workers. They really are. You're doing work that I couldn't do, but I'm sorry. Hugs, love, and kisses are not going to work. If they were, why are we killing 4 million dogs a year? Dogs don't need that. They need structure, guidance, okay? They need firm corrections. They need obedience. They need balanced people. So, really about the pack leader thing, Curtis and Mara says it's okay to fire clients. Absolutely, but you shouldn't hire them. You shouldn't let them hire you. I've fired a couple of clients before. You know. How do you know you're the pack leader? Well, you know, this is how you know. Let me give you a good example. What I would say is the pack leader. I take five dogs out, I'll tell you. Okay, here we go. You ready? A video. Diana, cue it up. There's a video of Angelo, who is two, and he was one and three quarters at the time. He was probably about 20 months old. There was six dogs in my front yard, all large. Four German Shepherds, a Pit Bull, and this feral dog, Autumn. She's just this feral dog. And this is Angelo. He probably weighs all of 20 pounds. I said, Angelo, I want you to take all these dogs and put them in their kennel. Angelo goes, okay. He walks over to a kennel door. He opens it up. He makes a grunting noise. All the dogs ran through the door. He followed them. And then he put them all in their kennel. That's a pack leader. Okay? When you can get six dogs to listen to a two-year-old, he's a pack leader. Okay, have anybody ever seen the out video? So Mac, who is a face-biting dog, came to me highly aggressive. Angelo can walk up to that dog that has a ball in his mouth, and he says, out. The dog drops it. Angelo picks it up. The dog never goes near him. He throws the ball. The dog goes and gets it. Angelo's a pack leader. If I can take a dozen dogs and they listen to me, by staying calm, I'm a pack leader. I just got really good energy. That's it. But that's through lots of practice. That doesn't mean I don't yell at my dogs. Trust me. I probably yell at my dogs every day. You know, I try not to. We all get frustrated. So, Allison wants to know, what point can you take the bark collar and the e-collar off when they stop doing separation anxiety? But I would don't get rid of your tools. Don't feel like it's not a failure to use tools. I know there's a lot of people out there. There's trainers that say, if you have to rely on tools, you're not very good. Okay. I'll be the first one to admit it then. I suck as a dog trainer, right? Cause I rely on tools. Sorry. That's what I do. I'm not lazy. I'm looking for results. Again, I want to empower owners. Okay. I work with dogs 8 to 10 hours a day. My clients, 10 to 20 minutes if they're lucky. And that doesn't make them bad clients. That doesn't make them bad dog owners. Everyone's got busy lives. Okay. Dog owners aren't dog trainers. They don't want to they don't care about a lot of this stuff. They just want their dog to listen. So allow them to use tools, right? I could have walked to work today. You know, it's only a mile and a half away. I got a car. I drove. All right. Brittany says, how do you establish it then? I have heard too many different views, and some you have to be mean to be it. You don't have to be mean to be a pack leader at all. You can actually advocate for the dog. Okay. Like I said, you don't have to be mean. I don't consider myself mean at all. Actually, just water. If you fill it up with water downstairs, and then there's a Lazy Susan, it's that apple cider vinegar, just literally go like that. Okay. You don't have to worry about the honey. So Peter, you don't have to be mean to be, your dogs will listen to you, but they're not going to respect you. Okay. Your employees will listen to you, but they won't respect you. So you have to be fair, and you've got to advocate. And you've got to set down rules and boundaries that the dogs understand. Okay, give them direction. That's what dogs want. Dogs want direction. Peter says, that's true. I use tools every day to teach students. And Peter says, I must suck as a teacher too. Nope, you don't. I'm sure you don't. Allison says, thank you, Jeff. You're truly inspiring. Love everything you do. Allison, thank you. Guys, you know, if I didn't have a line of questions here, I'd be sitting here doing nothing because look, This is my agenda today. I got nothing there. I'll take a note if I got to get back to a question or if I want to remember to do something. But this is all about you. This is all about you. This is everything about you. I'll answer that question. Let me go through some of these. Sometimes I'm forgetting to delete questions. Okay. Lauren, hey Jeff, tips for getting a consistent e-collar working level. We've brought the thick fur contact points. That's good, which helped a bit, but we're still struggling. Our dog has a thin neck, thick, longer fur, and doesn't seem to consistently exhibit. Thank you so much. Okay, so what I want you to do is I want you to get, Lauren, first of all, what model are you using and how high are you going before you still think you don't have a working level? I want you to get the Furminator. Do that, or you can even shave a little bit down. But tell me what model you're using, okay? Jill says, how would the T3 work? Just curious with the whole being 18 to 21 thing. Is it going to be the same thing that was at the seminar? Parents have to be with me the whole time. I'll have to see if I can get down there. What's the date? Oh, Jill, yeah, you folks, you're going to have to, yeah, it's 6 days, Jill. It's 6 days. Wow. God, this Jill girl, she's incredible. Jill, I'm so sorry. I was swearing. Jill, I didn't know you were on this webinar. Jill's 13 years old and I'm dropping S-bombs and F-bombs. Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry, Jill. Jill is this kick-ass girl who's like training dogs. That's a good question. You got to talk to Laura Morgan on that one, Jill. Go to Train the Trainers with Sean and Jeff. Email Laura, find out how that would be. What your folks could do is they'd have to stay up in Providence or wherever you were. Then they don't need to come. They don't need to hang out. They would drop you off during the day and then they'd pick you up at night. You know, find out about that. Find out about that. That's a really good question. We may or may not be able to do that, but gosh, I would hate to have somebody that's so young that wants to really empower herself. Could you imagine being a full-time dog trainer at the age of 15? Charging money. We actually had Nelson was 17 when he went to T3. So I can, Jill, you've got the maturity to do it. So talk to Laura about that. That's a great question. Thank you so much. Jill, thank you for coming in, for coming to these. Bree says, I'm still so excited for Richland, Ohio seminar. Can't wait to meet you in person. I'll be bringing my German Shepherd Rico with me. Bree, I can't wait to meet you. I'm taking the RV there. It's a Saturday, Sunday. I'll probably be getting there Friday morning or Thursday night. All depends on when I can get away from Providence. Okay. I'm just trying to make sure that I'm not going to repeat myself here. Sarah says, way too much love. Not enough brains in the rescue world. I only lasted a year. Wow, a year. Jeez. I lasted a day. Kudos to you, Sarah, man. Kudos to you. I love training. I feel like I help more dogs training than I did rescuing. Exactly. Exactly. Bottom line is this. If you're going to work in the rescue world, you're better off you're better off going to people's homes for free, right? You're better off going to people's homes for free. Keep dogs at homes. Keep them from going to a shelter. Good for you, Sarah. Hi, Jeff. This is from Marianne. Hi, Jeff. My dog has great e-collar heel after a few days. Awesome. Yeah. Now what do we do when he's the occasional walk with one or two dogs that he doesn't freak out with? They walked way out in front of their humans. Is the bad heel example once in a while okay in the interest of some okay. So are you trying to tell me that you go with your friends that are walking their dogs and they're way out in front? Because if you're walking three dogs, they all should be in heel. If this is my opinion only, the bottom line is if you have a leash on that dog should be next to you in heel. You want your dog out in front of you, it should be off leash. My opinion, okay? I want my dogs next to me or behind me, all right? That doesn't mean my dogs don't run and play. My dogs are off leash, got it? So if anybody followed my 10,000 mile, 9-week RV tour with girl, she wore a leash twice. Once when we were in St. Augustine, Florida. And that's what I actually physically harmed a 13-year-old kid because he tried to pet my dog and didn't listen to me. I'll talk about advocating for your dog. I'm not proud of that, but he also tried to pet my dog without asking and he didn't listen to me. So if anybody wants to know about that, if we run out of time, I'll talk about the bending kid's arm. Okay. All right. But help me out there, Marianne. Is it you walking three dogs or are you walking with your friends? If you're walking with your friends, use that opportunity to heal your dog even more. That's a high level distraction. But if you're at the park, the woods, your dog's off leash, it's off leash. Okay. Tony says, hello, Jeff. I have 8 dogs in my home. Oh my gosh. So you got your own kennel. Mostly Aussies, one of the bully breeds. They all have been living here for 7+ years. Good for you. Seriously, good for you. My bully dog attacked 2 different dogs in the last couple of months. Something's going on in that house. I think it was my energy being in the wrong place. Lost a dog about 3 months ago. Yep, there you go. So you've been grieving. Okay, we'll talk about that. So you've been grieving. I'm sorry that you lost your dog. It sucks. I never know what to say. Whenever anybody tells me they lost their dog, I'm like, I just go, it sucks. You know, I'm not religious, so I've never said, I've never told anybody that I'm praying for them because I don't pray. But when someone loses their dog, I'm like, losing a dog sucks. It does. It always sucks. I've lost dogs. What do I make sure doesn't happen again besides not showing as much affection, giving more rules and boundaries, hard to trust him again around the other dogs? All right. So this is what's happening, Tony. Most likely, one of your dogs died. Terrible. Got it? You fell from pack leader structure. Got it? You fell. The bully breed overtook you. Boom. Dog fight. That's probably what happened. He's been waiting. So what I would do is I would go do hardcore obedience with that dog. Okay? Hardcore obedience. Don't let that dog roam. Okay? Works for everything. Start back at the basics. I want that dog always in command somewhere. All right? But you got yourself a kennel. So what happened was also what could have happened is you might have been falling down in pack leader status and a couple of other dogs might have been trying to go up and he was the one that was the most forceful. Could have been that. Could have been that. I'm sorry, Tony, to hear about your dog dying. Gosh, you guys are awesome tonight. You guys are so awesome. Let me just take a quick 2-second break here. It's 10:15. He's only supposed to go for an hour, guys. Okay. Yeah, it's fine. Thank you so much. Is there enough in there? You better fill that up. Do I got to mix it for you? So.
That's good.
All right. Terry says, is there a way to look for specific videos on YouTube without scrolling through the myriad of videos you have available to us? I know, wouldn't that be convenient? They're all excellent, but sometimes I'm looking for a specific topic and I'm computer literate, much less YouTube literate. I know. You'd think, right? You'd think I'd have it organized. This is what I'm going to do, Terry. Number one, if you're on my Solid Canine Training YouTube page, you can type in the little, there's a little search button. You can do it, like separation anxiety. The issue is, if you're looking for a certain aggressive one, that's going to be hard because a lot of my titles say aggressive in it. Why? It's for my SEO. That's why. Because videos that say aggression in it get a lot of play. They show up in a lot of searches, a lot of So I do it for purely selfish promotional reasons. But what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be reorganizing my YouTube channel. You'll notice if people have been following me for a while, you'll notice that I'm going a little bit deeper now with my videos, right? I'm actually doing 2 webinars a week. I'm going deeper. I'm showing more of my protocols, showing more of my process from my Canadian people, more of my process. And you'll notice the reason is because I want everybody to train their own dogs, and I don't want people to have to hire a dog trainer if you don't need to, okay? I say this all the time, and people are like, why are you saying that? I'm like, I got a 2-month waiting list. I'll say that till the cows come home. Trust me, there's going to be plenty of clients that still want to hire me. So Terry, yeah, it's one of my projects is I'm going to be trying to get them better searchable, okay? Brittany says, how can I be positive and have a calm mindset during training when I just have so many frustrations from the day? I don't know how to get rid of my frustrations. Do they make chill pills? I think I need one. Of course they make chill pills, okay? But Brittany, let me give you a helpful hint here. Don't train dogs when you're frustrated. Got it? And why has your life got so many problems? Why is your life so frustrating? Why? Whatever is getting you frustrated, either you fix it or you get rid of it. What are you, in a dead-end job? Get rid of it. Okay? So if you want to live the life you want to live, you got to get rid of all that stuff. All right? You learn all that stuff from T3, by the way. Train the trainers. You learn all that stuff. You learn all that stuff on how to do that. Okay? Don't train when you're frustrated. Your dog can feel it. Your dog responds to it. So, oh my gosh, there's so many questions. Bree says, screw an hour. We're taking you hostage. You're right. You guys are. You won't shut up. Marianne says, okay, that's a good point. Use it as a distraction. Good. So, Marianne, it sounds like the other two dogs are with separate handlers and the dog's with you. Absolutely. Okay. It's a walk. It's training. You don't want to give your dog a mixed message. So, hey, trust me, talk to another dog trainer. Now let your dog out in front and let him be a dog and sniff and smell. All right. That's good. That's not my advice. Jill says, he can search for keywords using, one of the F2s, F2, F3, F4. I don't remember which one. We'll only put the ones with a certain word. For example, jumping protocol. Yeah. Jill, you've lost me. I imagine I was searching for YouTube videos. I know. Marianne says, no, a friend, one friend at a time, but they don't know about you. They sort of get walked by their dogs. Okay. Marianne, you could help them. They don't need to know about me. Tell them, get a prong collar, heal their dog. All right. Heal their dog. Brittany says, I wish there were like buttons for questions that are good. Just tell me you like them. All right. Curtis and Meredith say Jill can shadow us for free after T3T. I know. Curtis and Meredith, this girl's 13 years old and she's rocking it. Could you imagine that? Curtis, Meredith, could you imagine at 13 having, first of all, she can handle a dog, but then going to a T3? God, I wish I had that. Okay. Jill says their parents are asleep. We'll talk to them. There's nothing that's going to happen. The T3 we're doing is sold out anyway. This T3 in Providence. You got to wait till the next T3 in Providence. Sarah says May 9th and 10th, T3 Accelerated New Orleans. Yes, go to it. Your life will change. Your life will change. It's not a sales pitch. Trust me. Your life will change. If you like what you hear, okay, Sarah, if you like what you hear or anybody from my stuff here about non-dog training, that's what you learn. You learn all about anybody. You can go to as many dog training seminars as you want to, unless you learn the other stuff, personal growth, self-esteem, overcoming fear, client relations, business, you got to go to T3 for that. Okay. Claire says, sorry, I came in late. Claire, there's a penalty. You got to sing a song. You may have covered this. What's the easiest way to teach a four-month-old lab not to bite or chew on a leash? Love your advice. So Claire, what you can do is this. First of all, four-month-old dog, that's 16 weeks old dog. Do a couple of things. You can do bitter apple on the leash. You can also get a pet convincer. What's a pet convincer? Okay, this is a pet convincer. It's air. It's a modified bicycle pump. Ready? Shoot, sorry, girl. I just freaked out my dog. All right. Sorry, girl. Nope. So we use it to interrupt or correct. Girl plots. Good. I would use that. What you're doing is you're interrupting that. You're interrupting that. All right. That's what you're doing. Sarah says, Sarah lives 5 miles from us. She has to go. That's good. Talk to him. Talk to him, Curtis and Meredith. Oh, Sarah. Okay. You were talking about Sarah. I was talking about Jill, guys. Sarah should definitely go as well. Let's see. Bree, I would love to go to T3. I'll have to wait on my son to get older, though. Bring the kid. Come on. Put him in a sling. I'll take, how old's the kid? If he's a baby, I love babies. I'll take him. Linda will watch the kid. How old's the kid? Okay. We'll take care of him. Amy says, one of my goals for 2015 is to attend one of your T3 workshops. I'm madly in love with you guys. We're madly in love with you. And it's great. If you don't know what people don't know what T3 is, train the trainers with Sean and Jeff. Train the trainers with Sean and Jeff. It's life-changing. Brittany, you're a stay-at-home mom with a bachelor's degree in biological science. Maybe it's because I don't do anything I feel is worthwhile with my life than take care of my daughter and husband. All right, but Brittany, I understand that. I understand that. And, you know, you probably did your being a stay-at-home mom is a job. It's a full-time job. I mean, Linda homeschools. She homeschools the kids, you know, and, you know, she's incredible. And she's, she's a full-time homemaker and she loves it. She did just start this new Wicked Big Lashes, wickedbiglashes.com. She started this new business so that she can do in her spare time and she's really dedicated to it. Bree, your kid's 11 months. Oh, bring me that kid. Oh, I'll have so much fun. Seriously, Bree, I'll keep that kid on my back the whole time or on my front. I like to do the front papoose. I'll do that. Bring the kid, Bree. Jill says you can use me as a testimonial. I watched the videos, read the posts, listened to the webinars. Then I went to the seminar and it was like night and day. He's a superstar. This is Jill, the 13 year old woman who rocks it with her dog. She's the one that did her homework. Claire says, thanks, Jeff. Yeah. So try that bitter apple. I would do this, but you want to interrupt and or correct. Okay. Okay. That's Claire. Hold on. Oh, shoot. Ooh, I almost deleted somebody. Okay. Patty asked, what do you do to break a dog of chasing dusters, sweepers, and snow shovels? Let me guess, remote collar again. No, not necessarily. Sounds like I have to put my remote collar on all day. I have an invisible fence, so two prongs seem to be an overkill. Okay, listen. You can do a couple of things, okay? And this is the thing also, folks, is that the advice I give, I've done. See, this is the great thing about training so many dogs and training dogs mostly with problems. And I don't do, I do basic obedience, but I do a ton of behavior modification. So what I would do is teach the dog place command. Okay. Place command is go to a spot. Don't move. We like them to be lying down. So theoretically, let's think about this out loud, Patty. If the dog was in place, right? How could it chase the duster or sweeper? It can't. Right? It could, but then it's not in place. So let's start, before we say no, let's say go. Does that make sense? Let's say yes. I like to be balanced. I like to be fair. I need you to go to place. And if I take out the Swiffer, we do this all the time. Have you ever seen any of my videos where we vacuum? Dogs in place, we're vacuuming. Everyone's like, excuse me. I got throat spray. This isn't for bad breath, but I probably need something for that too. Diana's going, she already took out a pack of gum and mouthwash. She's like, Jeff, you need a double dose for that breath. So what everybody always says, oh, my dog would never do that. Stay in place. You think dogs come to us knowing commands? A week ago, that dog couldn't do it either. That's what training's about. Try a bonker. Dog goes after a snow shovel. No, boom. No, boom. Say no first. Hit the dog on the head. All right? Not you'd throw it at them. Dogs hate projectiles. You want to use a remote cower? Use a remote cower. Okay. Lauren says, thanks, Jeff. So we have clients of John's. We're clients of John's. Oh, okay. My John? Oh, cool. Use the Mini Educator 300. He's furminated our dog and shaved him in an earlier session. We're gone up to 32 to 35 looking for a working level. Other times he can react to a 19. Other times yelp at 8. Okay, so it's wrong. It's not fitting. I'm determined to use the e-cower, just struggling trying to get all the info. So when are you coming in next? Let me know when you're coming in and talk to John about it. If you must be a Sunday person then, because you must be one of the Sunday people. So let me know if you're one of the Sunday people, and I'll talk to John about it. But your working level should not be at 32 or 35. It's probably a bad fit. What we can do is we can do a little bit of shave. We'll do a little bit of a shave, but I wouldn't be surprised if it was fit. Also, you want to make sure you have the remote here or the remote here. You don't want to do it there. You're not going to hurt the dog, but you definitely want to do it. Curtis and Mara said Jill has to come. We'll help her get there. I know. Curtis, I know, guys. She's going to come. We're going to figure it out. She's going to come. Okay. Let's see. Doug, Brittany. Okay, Doug says, in dog rescue, it's a very common question. Is he good with other dogs? How can we answer that diplomatically? I've replied that all the dogs are from a shelter and under stress, so we cannot be sure. Yeah, I mean, it's hard to tell if dogs are good with dogs in a shelter environment because they're really stressed. And in the behavior of a dog in a shelter is not usually the behavior of the dog. The only way we know if dogs are good with dogs is we put them in a room off leash with other dogs. We take every single safety protocol that there is. But you don't know. But we take safety protocols. But we don't know if they're good with dogs until we work them, right? So we don't know if we're... So probably you gotta have a protocol in place. Jill says also, if any of your clients need any cat behavior stuff, cat beating on the dog, agitating to the point of fights, you can use me. Cats are jerks. Sometimes the dogs aren't the only problems, just a little shameless self-promotion. All right, Jill. I don't know anything about cat behavior. Marianne says, do I need to wait till we have 100% recall before doing any limited off-leash play with one dog? With their owners there, adopted mine 6 months ago and have been working hard on his dog reactivity. Okay, hold on. Not necessarily, but you want to do it in a fenced-in area. You want to do it in a fenced-in. So I would do it in a fenced-in area. So what we'll do is you can, because if the dog doesn't come back, you're sort of screwed, right? So I would do it in a fenced-in area. I would keep a long line on the dog, and then I would make sure you can get recall off the dog. The best thing to do is this. I can't stand dog parks. Nobody here should be going to dog parks. So what you should be doing is the dog should use the outside of the dog park, let your dog run up to the fence, and if you can't call your dog off of that, those dogs behind the fence, guess what? Your dog's not ready. All right. Lauren, I see your question. I see your response. All right, let me talk to John about that. All right, you shouldn't be struggling right now. All right, I'll make sure you get extra. You're going to get extra sessions. All right, Lauren, you're going to get extra sessions. I don't want to see you struggle like that. So, I'll talk to him about that. All right, I'll talk to him about that. We're going to set you up. Don't worry. Bree says, I'll bring my son to the next T3 that you do in Ohio. You're coming to RV though, right, Bree? You're coming to RV. You bringing the kid to RV? Bring the kid to RV. I'd love to see him. We can hang out all day. We'll find a nanny for him. What's that? That's right. Yeah, Diana might go. Who knows? By then, who knows? Maybe if I just stock the RV with wine, she'll just like, she'll go. She'll go. I learned about something. I've just, she's been here for 2 days. I'm learning a lot about her. All right. Marianne says, in my yard, it hasn't gone well because territorial. Could be. But bottom line is this. Recall is recall. Right, Marianne? Recall is recall is recall. That dog don't come back close to 100% of the time, 100% of the time. I don't care where that dog is. Okay? Where that dog is. We can't use the territorial as an excuse. Oh, you are bringing the kid. Good. Good, 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 good. Bringing the kid. You just got yourself a job. Okay? Claire says, love the idea, the bonker idea for the broom, et cetera. I'm going to have to work on place with my puppy more. He's up to about 30 seconds before he leaps off to attack the broom. He's 4 months old. You are so common sense. Thanks. I know. Guys, dog training is yes and no. It's do this, don't do that. Do this, don't do that. All right? So do this, good. Don't do that, no. It's really simple stuff. This is what it is. Dog trainers have huge egos, myself included, all right? We want you to think that we're so intelligent that you, the dog owner, could not possibly figure this out unless you hired us. That's what we do. We want to manipulate you. Like you need to go to school for animal behavior science to be a dog trainer. Baloney. Work with a bunch of dogs, okay? I didn't go to school for dog training. You know, everybody knows my story. It's on my website. 11 years ago, I got Max, okay? I didn't know anything about dogs. I got him at 5 weeks old. That's how stupid I was. I didn't know. Guess what? Attacking humans, attacking me, attacking other dogs, getting into dog fights. He was told to be put down. I went to a bunch of dog trainers. They told me to do all this stuff that didn't work. What did I do? I found someone that could help me, and then I studied. And then I started working with tons of dogs, tons of dogs, tons of dogs. It's not that difficult to do. Okay, I'm not doing sports. I'm not doing agility. I'm not a service dog trainer. I could do the public access part of service dog training. I don't do that. I don't do tasks. I don't do protection work. I do family dogs. Go lie down over there. Walk next to me. Shut up. Don't rush the door. Simple. And then I've got an extreme talent for working with aggression, which is a whole separate thing. It's a whole separate thing. And that's hands-on. But anytime a dog trainer tries to talk to you in language you don't understand, run. Run. They're trying to make you feel stupid, and they're trying to raise themselves up with their intelligence. You want to impress me? Grab the freaking leash and work my dog. That impresses me. Don't give me some handout with some fancy words on it and fancy, like, I don't understand this stuff. Okay. I'll get that dog straightened out on that e-collar. All right? You're not leaving. You're not done. Got it? No more money. You're not done until we fix that. All right? Thank you, Lauren. And John is great. No more questions. 94 minutes we did. We didn't do a poll. Think of a poll. Do you like red wine or white wine better? For diet as mine is that.
How many more glasses?
So I can't thank everybody enough for doing this webinar with me. And it really means a lot to me. It really does. It's I'm passionate about what I do, and I should just start saying this every time, and I've said it before. Everybody assumes I'm a dog lover. God, of course I love dogs, but I'm actually can't stand. I do what I hate. Linda hates when I say this. She's like, I hate when you say you do what you hate. That sounds so negative. Let me explain. I do what I hate, and I hate to see people in pain. All right? I'm a people person. I hate to see people in pain. I am so tired of families struggling. I'm tired of it. Okay? I'm tired of people calling me up and crying and having to give up their dogs and for simple stuff. Okay, I do what I hate. I hate to see you in pain. That's my motivation. That's what motivates me to do what I do. I wake up every day and I say, I can't wait to help more people. I look so forward to these webinars because I know I'm going to be helping people. I love making my YouTube videos because they help people. It's all for free. Doug says, I like Monday, Wednesday, 9 p.m. Eastern time for the webinar. Doug, that's what everybody else says, okay? And that keeps the lawyers away, okay? I've been promised the lawyers won't, I won't be served papers if I only do two webinars a week. Lauren says, got it, good. Kim says, thank you so much for all you do. I am learning so much. Love it, dogs. Good. I need everybody to keep showing up to these webinars on Monday and Wednesdays, and I want everyone to tell all their friends. Jill says, any way I can swing down and work with some controlled dogs with Zane, looking to step up the distraction without using dogs that can't be controlled. Jill, there's a fee for that. Okay, there's a fee. You know, wait, hold on. Are you my Jill? If you're my Jill, yes, you can. Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought you were another Jill. Yeah, you can swing down. Do a shadow program with me. Do a short shadow. Claire says, you're awesome, Jeff. Thanks for your passion and encouragement. Thank you. Sarah says, I can't wait to meet you in May. I emailed Lori yesterday about info for hotels close to the seminar. Awesome. That's great. Sarah, you're going to love it. No, that's New Orleans. That's Sarah. That I can't wait. Can you imagine? Sarah, the weekend in New Orleans, learning, eating, what are those things called? Beignets? Those in New Orleans, the beignets are like those puff pastry. You never been? I think they got those beignets with a powdered sugar. Cafe Le Monde. It's a famous place. Oh my gosh. I can't wait. Stacy says, don't forget to share the bended arm story of the kid. Thank you for all you do. We're out of time. I'll tell you the story about the bend of the arm. So listen, nobody pets my dogs. I don't want people to pet my dogs. So I was in the two times that girl was on a leash were down in St. Augustine, Florida. Do you know that's the oldest city in the country? Do you know that? So we're in St. Augustine, Florida, and Linda is in a shop, and me and Angelo and the two other kids were on a bench. There's a photo of us actually sitting on a bench with, if you look back in Facebook, during my RV tour, I forgot the month that was in. We're on a cement bench. Girl's in a downstay. And this kid, 10 to 13 year old, comes running over with his arm, ready to go with girl. And I'm pretty quick. I just grab him by the wrist, grab him by the hand, bend it back. He went to the, he was in pain, and he went away. And I'm like, don't ever touch my dog. What does he know? You're running up to a German Shepherd and you're going to go and touch my dog? So consequence, right? Like, who parented that child? So consequence for bad behavior. Guess what? I bet you he doesn't do it again. Why? Because there was a consequence. Jill says, got to work out some personal stuff first. Have to get to school. Can Linda homeschool me? No, man. Linda doesn't want any more kids. Claire says, Cafe Dumont. That's right. Yeah, I know. Isn't that awesome? Cafe du Monde. Allison, I just told the story about the kid. Claire says, love your video so much. Gonna see if I can come in RV or T3, anything in the South. I'm doing Gainesville, Florida. I forgot when. Look at RVDogTrainer.com. Go to RVDogTrainer.com and go to train the trainers with SeanandJeff.com. And you'll see what we're doing. As far as the South, we're doing New Orleans for Train the Trainers. It's a two-day accelerate one. I'm doing RV Dog Trainer, which is just myself. It's a two-day. It's geared towards dog owners. Debbie says, thank you, Jeff. Sarah says, I can't wait to meet you. Oh, we already did that. Good. Allison says, thank you. You're welcome, Allison. Vanessa says, I made it to 439. Luke as well. Good. Guys, I love you guys. You're good. Okay? So Vanessa, pass on that information that I said, that I told you about mom, all right? We can't have any negativity in your life, okay? Right? We can't. We shouldn't be having negativity. We have to surround ourselves with people that bring us up and not bring us down, okay? So let's do that. I'm proud of you guys. Proud of you. Michelle says, night, Jeff. Have a good night. Thank you, Jeff. Good. All right. I got to close this one up. All right. So if you missed any part of this webinar, it's going to be on YouTube tomorrow. We had a technical difficulty. I think I've got an assistant, that Melissa, she does these. I think she'll be able to put them both together. She'll probably just separate out the break where it went off the air. Yeah, she'll figure it out. Okay. And don't forget, I've got a radio show on Saturday morning. It's an official radio show. So what you can do is on the radio show, you can log in as well. There'll be a login code on Saturday morning as well. And you can see us in the studio just like this. Jill, if people say they can't come, I watch Mondays on a red eye flight. Nothing is impossible. That's great. Peter says, thanks, Jeff. See you next Wednesday. The webinar, Janine, Sarah, good night. Thank you. All of you, thank you. Excuse me. Thank you. Really, thank you. I mean, without this, I can't do it. All right, Doug, in New Orleans, get the Pitbulls and Pearlies TV show to have you as a guest, showing them how to handle. Doug, okay, I'm not interested in doing anything with Pitbulls and Pearlies. All right? Okay, sorry. They've got a perfect opportunity to be trained in a lot of bully breeds, and they're not. Okay? I'm sorry. Those dogs are dragging their butts around. Okay, they're dragging their butts around. Okay, they're putting them on slip leads and they're getting their butts dragged around. I got a problem with that. She's not interested anyway. She's not interested in our help. Okay, Sean's down in New Orleans. She's not interested. But good suggestion. Good suggestion. Thanks, Doug. I like all your input. Bree says, good night. Good night. Kiss your baby. Good night, Bree. All right, I'm looking forward to seeing you. Okie doke. That's it. Good night. That's it. All right. Stopping the broadcast.